Hello everyone, myself Bhakti Khandekar from Group 102. Here we all will present a short info on Russian heroes. So my topic is Dmitry Mendeleev. Dmitry Mendeleev was born on 8 February 1834 in the village of Verkhny near Tobolsk to Ivan and Maria Mendeleev. Dmitry was raised as an Orthodox Christian, his mother encouraging him to patiently search divine and scientific truth. Mendeleev was the youngest of 17 siblings. In 1849, his mother took him across Russia from Siberia to Moscow with the aim of getting Mendeleev enrolled at the Moscow University. The university in Moscow did not accept him. The mother and son continued to St. Petersburg. The now poor Mendeleev family relocated to St. Petersburg, where he entered the main pedagogical institute in 1850. Between 1859 and 1861, he worked on the capillarity of liquids and working on the spectroscope. Later in 1861, he published a textbook named Organic Chemistry. This won him the Demidov Prize of the Petersburg Academy of Sciences. Mendeleev became a professor at St. Petersburg Technological Institute and St. Petersburg State University in 1864 and 1865. In 1865, he became Doctor of Science of his dissertation on combinations of water with alcohol. He achieved tenure in 1867 at Petersburg University and started to teach in organic chemistry. By 1871, he transformed St. Petersburg into an internationally recognized center for chemistry research. He is best remembered for formulating the periodic law and creating a far-sighted version of periodic table of elements. He used the periodic law not only to correct the accepted properties of some known elements, such as valency and atomic weight of uranium, but also to predict the properties of 8 elements that were yet to be discovered. So this is all about my topic. Thank you for listening, and the next will be continued by my friend Bhavika.
My name is Bhavika Parayani and I am from group 102, and my topic is Nikolai Skulfutsky. Was a well-known Russian surgeon who would actually span up to 50 hours at the operating table without sleep but rest of food. His talent was recognized quite early. He was only a little over 40 with his name began to be a pronounced with ave and administration throughout the world. After that, Nikolai was a true gentleman. No one could remember him losing his temper. He tried to stay calm irrespective of the situation. The great surgeon, though he was a very emotional person, but he remembered that when he witnessed his first operation performed without chloroform, he fainted. Skulfutsky was extremely shy. He hated being praised and tried to avoid honors in any form. Nikolai and his wife Sofia performed a hospitable and open couple. Their house was often visited. Skulfutsky was a famous Russian composer and a well-known artist. Skulfutsky and his wife, both having received a brilliant education, had vast interests that was not limited to medicine. Skulfutsky loved painting and art and was interested in literature and music. His wife was an international Vienna music context, and his daughter Olga was a talented musician. As Skulfutsky, in 1863, he renewed surgeon presented in this entitled Hemal Purjunya Tumor. It was a great success, and 3 years later, Skulfutsky set off on a business trip to attend advanced training courses. During the next 2 years, he worked in Germany, France, England, and Scotland, where he studied foreign approaches to opening a cyst and a central fungi. Skulfutsky has also had an opportunity to take a very close look at a military medicine with permission from the Austrian government to took part in the Austria-Prussian War of 1866, working in sick quarters and field dressing station. Over time, his name became increasingly famously a medical circles. In 1870, upon the recommendation of Prigu, his department chair at the Kiev University, a year later he was summoned to St. Petersburg, where he asked to teach surgical pathology in the Medico-Surgical Academy, where at the time he was only education institution where a military medics were taught. And in 1878, he became head of the surgical clinic in St. Petersburg. He wrote and published several works and became one of the best known talented surgeons in Russia. After that, in 1876, Kolfe went off to the another war, this time to Chikungunya, and he served as a surgery aide for the Red Cross. In 1877, he took part in the Russian-Turkish war. He worked in a sick quarter, stamped upon the wounded, and performed operations in the field. Working side by side with Pirigu, on some occasions, Kolfe worked 70 hours without sleep and rest. His wife, Sophia, never left her husband. They worked side by side, whereas Kolfe was surmount, Sophia was a nurse. According to the some report, during the war, Kolfe had to treat strep up and operate 10,000 wounded. Last year, after the Moscow period, Kolfe moved back to the St. Petersburg, where he lived for another 10 years, teaching practical surgery. His courses attracted hundreds of young, experienced doctors from all over. In 1902, he resigned due to a serious illness and moved to his country estate. Kolfe used to spend summers here when he was a younger. He had avoided the place since his first wife, aged 24 at the time, and their children died there of typhoid fever. After that, his scientific achievement was he developed a system of surgical treatment of certain disease. Without him, it would be impossible to operate a cyst, treat several fungi and alleviate the jaws. Kolfe kept him with the European medical achievement. He tried to perform plastic surgery and promoted the methods of aspect and antiseptics. After that, he has done some public activity, like he has figured he took an active and a conversing meeting of Russian surgeon. Apart from that, he was a chairman of an international doctors congress that took place in Moscow in 1897. Neither did Kolfe forgot about specialist literature. He was co-editor of the medical magazine, the Surgical Chronicle, the first magazine of surgeons were to be published in Moscow, and the founder of another magazine, the Russian Surgical Archive. He wrote more than 70 articles on and surgery, become the basis for a new era of surgery in Russia. Nikolai Kolfe was a great number of students, colleagues, and followers, including Stubers, Kuzmin, Yakulve, Yanuske Chupro. Thank you. And the further topic will be explained by my friends.
Okay, thank you so much, Bhavika. As myself, Rushikesh Murthy, I'm from group 102, and my topic is Nikolai Lobachevsky. Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky was a Russian mathematician and geometer known primarily for his work on hyperbolic geometry, otherwise known as Lobachevskian geometry, and also his fundamental study on Dirichlet integrals known as Lobachevsky integral formula. He was born on 1st December 1792 near the city of Nizhny Novgorod in the Russian Empire. He was one of the three children. When he was seven, his father, a clerk in land surveying office, died, and Nikolai moved with his mother to Kazan. Lobachevsky attended Kazan Gymnasium from 1802, graduating in 1807, and then received a scholarship to Kazan University, which was founded just 3 years earlier in 1804. At Kazan University, Lobachevsky was influenced by Professor Johann Christian Martin Bartels, a former teacher and friend of German mathematician Carl Friedrich Gauss. Lobachevsky received a Master of Science in Physics and Mathematics in 1811. In 1814, he became a lecturer at Kazan University. In 1860, he was promoted to Associate Professor. In 1822, at the age of 30, he became a full professor teaching mathematician, physics, and astronomy. He served in many administrative positions and became the rector of Kazan University in 1827. Some mathematicians and historians have wrongly claimed that Lobachevsky, in his studies in non-Euclidean geometry, was influenced by Gauss, which is untrue. Gauss himself appreciated Lobachevsky's published works very highly, but they never had personal correspondence between them prior to publication. Although three people, Gauss, Lobachevsky and Bolyai can be credited with discovery of hyperbolic geometry. Gauss never published his ideas, and Lobachevsky was the first to present his views to the world mathematician community. Lobachevsky's magnum opus Geometria was completed in 1823, but was not published in its exact original form until 1909, long after he had died. Lobachevsky was also the author of New Foundation of Geometry. He also wrote Geometrical Investigations on the Theory of Parallels in 1840 and Pangeometry in 1855. The great mathematician Nikolai Lobachevsky was died on 24 February 1856 at the age of 63 and was buried in Arskoye Cemetery, Kazan. And the thank you, friends. And the further topic will be continued, my friend Alan.
Hi guys, I'm Alan Sebastian of Medical Faculty 102, and I'll be talking about Alexander II, the Liberator. So we'll talk about his childhood and his education. Alexander the eldest son of Tsar Nicholas I, was born in Moscow on April 29, 1818. From the early age, the boy readied for the throne, tutored by the poet and luxury critics Wesley Zaworski. The young heir apparent received abroad and throughout education from arts and language to science and rigorous military training. To complete his schooling at the age of 19, he embarked on an extensive tour of Russia and Europe. During his European travel, Alexander met his future wife, Princess Maria of Hesse. The couple married in 1841 and had 8 children. So, let's talk about the way he started to rule. The beginning of the rule, Alexander became Tatar on the death of Nicholas I in 1855 at age of 36. He already was matured and experienced statesman from his father. Alexander inherited the bloody Crimean War, which correlated with Turkey, Oled, Ottoman Empire, Britain and France. Russia's self-based economy couldn't support the cost of warfare, and loss of life was tremendous, and the year of Tatars began to peace talk. The Treaty of Paris ended in a bloodshed, but Russia lost its dominance in the Balkans, and in its warship were banned from the Black Seas. Then I'll be talking about some foreign policy, like which he implemented. Meanwhile, in the international arena, Russian weight was all-time low. Remembering the embarrassment of the Crimean War, Alexander dreamt of restoring his country and status influence. Military spending skyrocketed and the army was restructured and rearmed to fit the European standard. The Tatars soon got a chance to test his brand new military might against the powerful and dealt him a humiliation defeat with 2 decades earlier. But after a military triumph, Russia faced a devastating diplomatic defeat. The Tatar initially dictated the term of peace settlement. The Ottoman Empire considered the creation of a large Bulgarian state, but the European power, most of all England and Austria's Hungary, anxious, and Russia's increasing influence gathered Berlin, calling there another treaty. Not able to afford another war, Alexander could only watch as much his effort were erased. He later recalled one of the darkest pages of Russian diplomacy. Then I will talk some of his personal life, which happened after the war. The war took its toll on Alexander. He inherited his interest in politics weakens, and he felt exhausted and sought to refuge in his private life. By that time, he had embarked the greatest and the love affair of his life, his passionate romance with Princess Catherine Douglasco. Their 14-year-long year of relationship began in the summer of 1866. The love between 47-year-old empire and an 18-year-old schoolgirl was condemned by a court and the royal family, but it did not stop Alexander. His wife's health was failing in 1880. Less than a month after her death, Alexander married a long-lasting mistress, and by the time Catherine had to bore 4 children, but their matrimonial union provided a short live. And that's all for today, guys, and thank you for listening.